Og akkurat i kveld så hun her. Velkommen, Annie Mersson.
We have to go back to the very start of this adventure. You, at the age of 21, you were well educated, ready for a career, mm-hmm. and you decided to apply for a job in the Foreign Office. And it turned out that you were offered quite a different job. Tell us about the recruiting process.
Yes, I sort of fell into spying by accident, and in fact many of my peer group did. I quite fancied being a diplomat. I was 21, the idea of travelling the world and swilling back champagne at embassy parties really appealed. And I had this letter in response to my application on Ministry of Defence notepaper, which said very mysteriously, there may be other jobs you would find more interesting. No more information apart from a telephone number if I wanted to ring up and find out. And I don't know why, but my very first gut instinct response was, oh, fuck, it's MI5. Ever the lady. And I was going to ignore it because they had a stinking reputation at that point. There'd been a series of scandals in the 1980s of them spying on trade unionists and civil liberties people. So I wasn't going to call. Unfortunately, I opened the letter and my father was in the room with me. And he was a journalist. He was an investigative journalist. He was also a bit of a spy geek. So he was basically saying, please, please ring up and see if it is the spies. And lo and behold, it was. So a couple of months later, I found myself in an unmarked building in central London, being quizzed about my life from the age of 12 onwards by an intelligence officer. And about halfway through this very long interview, she said, well, why do you think you're here? I said, are you MI5? And I felt like a real fool for saying it. What if I was wrong? And she said, yes, we are. Please sign a notification of the Official Secrets Act. We cannot continue. Anyway, the whole process went on for about 10 months after that. It was very, very intensive. And at every point, I was entirely honest, you know, and they seemed to keep asking me back. And they were very reassuring about the fact that they were misrepresented in the media and that they had to now obey the law. So in early 1991, I finally walked in and started work there. I knew nothing about what their work was, what, apart from my grade and my salary at that point.
And you were confident that you were going to be given important and fine tasks. But tell us about the kind of work that you did in as a secret agent.
Well, I was recruited at a time when they said they wanted to change their work. They wanted people who could work on fast-paced terrorist targets. So I assumed I'd be straight into that. Unfortunately, my first posting was to a little section studying political subversion, which was precisely the sort of thing they said they didn't do anymore. So that was the first shock. I was there for 2 years, and then I moved on to Irish terrorism and then on to international terrorism. And when you're an intelligence officer, you're given these targets, and then you have this whole array of different means you can investigate the targets with. So you can put on telephone taps, you can bug their properties, their cars, intercept their email, have them followed around, or even recruit human agents to go and report on these people. It's very intrusive. And then, of course, you get all the information coming back, and you have to assess, is this person a terrorist? Are they going to plant a bomb? What do we do? Or are they entirely innocent, and should we just stop investigating them? So it could be a very satisfying job, but there are a number of issues, shall we say, with the way that they work.
And you also describe being part of the Secret Service as living in a parallel universe. And in the end, you ended up feeling that you had difficulties sort of contacting the normal world, so to speak.
I think they have increasing difficulties. The longer they're in, the more dislocated they get. Yes, it is very insulating. And you find that you can't be fully yourself with anyone else. So you gradually lose touch with your old friends because you can't talk about your work. So there are a number of friendships and even relationships going on within the spies. But it's also weird as well because you might be working on a terrorism case, for example, and something goes wrong and a bomb goes off on a British street. And you just see the news and you think, oh, God, this is terrible. The sense of guilt is overwhelming. But, of course, none of the backstory is reported. And the same thing can happen as well if you have a successful operation, say, you seize a cache of arms or something like that. And, again, you just see the tip of the iceberg in the news. You think, that was me, I did that.
And you can't talk to anyone about it.
Because you can't, no.
It's secret.
It's very strange. You become very isolated.
And you, in fact, ended up finding a boyfriend within the MI5, David Schuyler. And the two of you gradually discovered what you found to be very disturbing matters that were going on in the Secret Service. What was it that you discovered that you were unable to keep silent about?
Well, there's a whole list of things, really. It became more and more serious. I mean, it's a process almost of boiling a frog, I don't know if you know that phrase. So in the political section, we saw files held on government ministers. We saw hundreds of thousands of files held on UK citizens for their political activity, which was unlawful. There were illegal phone tap operations on journalists in the UK. There was the wrongful conviction of two innocent Palestinian students for a bombing in London in 1994, even though MI5 knew they were innocent and they would tell the information. And most seriously of all was what became known as the Gaddafi assassination plot. And this was the case that made us quit and made us go public. Mm. And a very quick summary, we had MI6, which is a sort of James Bond wing of British intelligence, funding a group of Islamic extremist terrorists in Libya with connections to Al-Qaeda to try and assassinate Colonel Gaddafi of Libya in 1996. Now, this operation was unlawful under UK law, and it went wrong and it killed innocent people. And of course, it didn't get the guy they were supposed to get then. So we couldn't think of anything more heinous, really. So we decided, well, what can we do? And in the UK, once you've signed the Official Secrets Act, the only people you can go to legally are your own agency. You can't go to your MP, you can't go to the police, anybody, without breaking the OSA. So David thought, well, he's tried talking about all this with NOR5, and they just said, we're not interested, don't rock the boat. Mm. Just keep your head down.
And then in the end, you decided to go to the media. You
yes,
blew the whistle, as we say.
It's a current phrase now, I think, yes, but then it was rather unusual.
You gave the whole story to a newspaper, and then on the very day that the story broke in the papers, you fled the country. What was it like to be on the run?
It was like a very bad spy novel. It was actually much more being like a real spy, according to literature, than working for the agency had been. But it was very frightening because, of course, by going public, we risked arrest and prosecution and 2 years in prison. So we ended up on the run around Europe for a month, just using cash, not using cards, that sort of thing, even disguising ourselves, putting our hair up and wearing funny clothes and never using our real names and moving from hotel to hotel. With MI5 and the British Secret Police and MI6 all hot on our trail, it was like something out of the Keystone Cops. And it was incredibly stressful. I mean, I used to joke that I lost a ton of weight. Well, not literally a ton, but it felt like it in that month. And I called it the Shayla Stress Diet. But it was very, very frightening to go through that, like a sort of surreal backpacking holiday.
Mm. This was quite an ordeal for you. And these are very serious allegations. Mm. Why was it inevitable for you to do this and talk about it?
I think it was, well, David was the key whistleblower. It was just in his nature to fight injustice and to see innocent people murdered, paid for by the British taxpayer via the British spies. We just didn't want to be part of an intelligence community that did that. And since he went public, other information has emerged. I mean, there were leaked documents from MI6 standing up what he said, but the British government managed to avoid having an inquiry into this by lying.
And what happened in the end? It was David who was the guy who had fronted the whole thing, and he was the one who was chased. In the end, he was arrested in France. Mm. The British tried to get him extradited. France refused. In the end, he went back to London voluntarily and was taken to court and convicted. Mm. You were arrested, but not convicted in the case. How will you describe the way the British authorities have handled this story over so many years, dragging it out and constantly trying to undermine your integrity and David's as well?
It's a classic response. They basically use a sledgehammer to crack a walnut every time because they think that if they push back really hard against the whistleblower, it will deter other people from doing it in future. So to watch him go through two high-profile court cases with the glare of the media, to watch him go to prison, not once, but twice, and he was the one exposing the crimes of others. He was just the whistleblower, and other people in the spy agencies had actually conspired to murder people. They got away scot-free. I still feel very sad about what happened and ashamed of the intelligence agencies in my country for not investigating these sort of crimes.
You are now living abroad in Germany. You're a writer, you give lectures. Do you still look over your shoulder?
All the time, yes. My paranoia is ingrained now. There's an English phrase that you're not paranoid if they're really out to get you. And I know for the first few years, certainly we had our home was bugged, our phones were bugged, some of our friends had to report on us. And you can't really lose that sense. So even now, I don't feel that I can necessarily trust my phone not to be bugged. I mean, it plays up occasionally. And I don't feel necessarily I can have a private conversation within my own home. So I do know what it's like to live under rampant surveillance, which is partly why I've become a lecturer and a writer about civil liberties issues. I can see what it would be like to live under a police state, something like the Stasi or the Gestapo or something like that. And I have to say, looking at some of the laws that are being brought in the UK, they are very much, very close to being a police state now.
Annie Machon, thank you for your story and thank you for coming here.
Thank you.